I love old stuff, not a surprise to anyone I know, but it wasn't always this way. As a man of culture, I get a lot of questions. Questions that I used to ask myself, ranging from why do you do this, to what is the best way to store my anime VHS tapes. I'll be getting into the more technical stuff in a bit, but to answer the question I get a lot, is why. Like, why do I collect these tapes? And at first I didn't even have a VCR, I just thought the tapes were cool. But after collecting for a while, I eventually found a 1986 Panasonic top loader and the maintenance manual for it, so I started refurbishing it. After replacing the idler wheels and fixing the tensions, I got it working like pretty much brand new, and I then found a 1982 Sanyo TV to match. At this point, I started going to buddies' houses and doing group watches of the tapes I had found or bought on eBay, and we'd make a night of it and get absolutely blasted on cheap booze. The first time we watched Golden Boy was actually on VHS, and we lost our shit. I still remember the first time I accidentally brought a hentai tape, at which point I didn't realize that some of this was porn. I mean, it makes sense now, but anyways, here's my porn. The tape I popped in was the Nightmare Campus movie, and there were like 10 of us all losing our minds at the spectacle of a demon leveling a city block using nothing but its dick. Absolutely wild. At that point, I was pretty much sold. This was in like 2017, and I still do them whenever possible, so just the social experience of discovering something new and being surprised is something that wouldn't be possible if we looked this stuff up and downloaded it beforehand. Even just that experience makes this collection worth having in my mind, and some of these tapes are very important to me just because of the memories made while watching them with others. And that's kinda how it all started in a nutshell. So it's very interesting that in the last 40 years, the anime VHS community has largely remained unchanged. The way that these tapes get around and the way that members of the community interact is still the same as it was back in the 90s. We're still, you know, mailing tapes to each other, trading to collect sets. There's still like an active community that's collecting fan subtitled versions to get archives of those. It's all very interesting. So I suppose it behooves me to explain the origin and the history of these tapes, namely because I can. So I'm going to take you back in time and try to put you in the mindset of our great weeb ancestors and how we got to this point. This all kind of started back in the late 1970s. Japan's economy was doing shit that makes Wall Street bets look like sound financial advice, and stockbrokers in the West were forced to watch as Japan nutted on every page of the Financial Times like it was a bathroom Sears catalog. With the bubble in full swing, Japanese domestic animation could be confident that it was smashing Disney's sweet little pussy. But this was pre-internet, so the West hadn't quite caught wind of what was going on. That wasn't until much later. In my humble and correct opinion, the most important factor which led to the OVA era and the early booms of anime was actually the birth and standardization of the home video market. When this all really got started, the VCR in Japan was this weird $4,000 box people mistook for a toaster, and the rest of the world had yet to even consider the concept of owning home video. So in the 70s, unbeknownst to the world, Japan was battling the greatest unarmed conflict in human history. It would be known later as the videotape format war. In the late 1970s, home video was expensive, confusing, and inconvenient. Many companies had begun to develop their own solutions, but the recording methods and video inputs were different for each company, and many forms of tape media weren't cross-compatible with each other. So in 1974, in order to avoid customer confusion, the Japanese government attempted to force the Japanese video industry to standardize to just one home video recording format. I say attempted because upon hearing the news, Japanese tech companies fell into what I can only describe as a cocaine-fueled panic. Before, companies were only worried about turning a profit and competing with each other. But if only one video format was allowed, suddenly it was a fight for corporate survival. Despite all this, in 1974, Sony's proprietary Betamax format was recognized by the government as the new standard for home video, and the format war was over. Until I shit you not, a year later, a couple of engineers at JVC were like, "Hey Sony, we think Betamax is stupid, so we're gonna make VHS the new format." Sony was like, "Wait, you can't do that, it's illegal." And after thinking about this for a while, JVC said fuck you and did it anyways. This is why throughout the 80s and 90s, watching anime was a complete clusterfuck. When my generation looks at this time with rose-colored glasses, we don't realize how much of a pain in the ass thing. For one, the only way to find out about half of these shows, even in Japan, was to either go to the video store or go through mail order catalogs. We also completely missed the fact that studios would occasionally just straight up release new episodes on completely different video formats, and if you don't have the specific hardware, you were screwed. Between VHS, Betamax, and Laserdiscs, one would need to own $12,000 worth of microwave-sized boxes to actually enjoy all of the early OVA offerings. And the OVAs themselves? They were expensive. Like, really expensive. Despite all of this, people were happy. They didn't even think about it. They got to watch anime, and come hell or high water, nothing would stop them. This financial barrier would lead to a lot of the early anime bootlegging circles, and much of the West's early experiences with anime were actually through these pre-internet piracy operations. Piracy operations sounds a little pretentious, though. In the early days, it was just small groups of otaku and foreigners mailing tapes internationally to buddies who would then reproduce the tapes en masse and distribute them to their buddies. On and on, muffled whispers were exchanged in dark rooms about massive demon cocks and tapes passed off with sweaty palms. Over months and sometimes years, these tapes would crawl across the country collecting the smell of virginity and semen as they went. This probably sounds great, like, hey, these people were able to experience being part of the secret club of arcane weebs. But again, this was, by modern standards, absolutely awful. People now get upset about misspelled subtitles, but half of these tapes didn't have subtitles. You or your buddies just had to guess what was going on, and the few that did have subtitles, oh boy, that Todd guy at the video store who smells like cheesies and stares at your ass is the only one in town with the equipment to do it. Not only that, but his knowledge of Japanese is from an exchange program he did in high school. Your tape sleeves are crusty when you get them back because every time he's trying to translate anime, he suddenly recalls his high school crush, Lucy, and busts. Even if you passed the gauntlet of Todd, these tapes at some points would be duplicates of duplicates, and each VCR would add its own flavor of distortion to the videos. If you were sitting at the end of this gypsy caravan, the anime you got could be a 10th generation copy, at which point it was so full of static and distortion, it would be unwatchable by modern standards. But that's the thing, you didn't care. You were happy in the moment because you got to watch some anime with all your friends, and that was all that mattered. Your parents were out doing something, you didn't care what, but they wouldn't be back till late, so you and your friends had 4 hours where you could huddle around the TV and watch that Akira movie the old guys at the video store were always talking about. Now, those memories, they seem so far away. Sometimes late at night, when you're alone, something reminds you of that. And you think about the way things could have turned out. You would do anything to go back. Because despite how inconvenient and slow everything was, that day was the last time you can remember where you were truly happy and unburdened with the responsibilities of life. This is why people really want to go back. For people from Gen X, the inconvenience was just how life was, and for some of my generation, the early internet didn't allow for these organic and earned experiences, so many of us are nostalgic for memories that really aren't our own. Some things like those memories of simpler times or the OVA era can only happen when the right people come together at the right time. While we can never go back, we can remember. And that's what this video is really about. It's about remembering the history and appreciating this format for what it really was. On the topic of remembering things, or specifically forgetting them, due to the difficulties of collecting multiple formats and the eventual death of Betamax and Laserdisc formats, many shows that were given exclusive Beta or Laserdisc releases are now lost forever, or only exist through low-quality rips of bootlegged VHS tapes. But with renewed interest in these shows, some are actually being recovered or restored. Most of the format-specific shows that survived from this time were either brought into the VHS format with Western releases or preserved on Laserdisc or the original 16mm film until they could be directly digitized and re-released onto DVD and Blu-ray. This increased interest in media preservation has done well to drag dead media back into the light of day, and this monumental task is what motivates many VHS and Laserdisc collectors today. This ideology is also closely in line with the game preservation movement. To most, it seems very stupid, but these large physical collections, once digitized, will be the only way future generations can enjoy and experience some of this media, regardless of how weird or depraved it happens to be. So on the topic of very stupid and large physical collections, at this point, let's say you have a large collection and are happily enjoying your shows, and one day you pop in your favorite tape, only to find out that it looks like ass. Put simply, the tapes themselves are mechanical devices, and the magnetic film inside of the tape contains a chemical soup that degrades over time. I'm still surprised by the number of people with decently large collections that either don't know or don't care about proper tape storage. I can't count the number of batches I've bought where half the tapes were half rewound and the tapes were all fuzzy or the tracking was off because of improper storage. I'm just gonna say this. There's no excuse. Like, I don't care if you don't have enough shelf space. If your tapes are lying sideways on top of each other, stop buying tapes for a minute, go to IKEA, and buy some shelves. That's all you gotta do. I'll link a comprehensive PDF guide for this in the comments, but this is my quick and dirty guide for tape storage. Store the tapes vertically and fully rewound. Sideways storage and bad rewinds will result in something called flange packing. Flange packing often leads to damaged edges from the tape scraping against the edge of the flange as it unwinds through the recorder and winds back to the reel. When a poor wind with popped strands is also present, the strands that stick out of the pack can be severely bent when the tape is flanged packed. Basically, the tape gets loose and it sags. So when it's moving around in the VCR, the edges of the film can rub on things and ruin the tape's tracking. By the same token though, not all rewinds are created equal. Excessive tension at any speed leads to a tape pack showing radial lines known as spokes. These radial lines result from the pressure of the outer layers in the pack compressing the inner layers so that the turns develop a kink. These kinks align radially and appear as a spoke when you look through the flange at the edge of the tape. Proper winding tension and good quality equipment is required to avoid this. Do not use cheap tape rewinders. Tape rewinders can save you wear and tear in your VCR heads, but can also over or under tension a tape. If you see bumps in your tape reels after a rewind, this is the result of bad tensioning. Immediately unwind and rewind the tape using better equipment. The tape may return to normal, but there is a risk of the tapes being stretched in places, which leads to wrinkled edges and subsequent tracking issues and tape-to-head contact problems. Periodic rewinding for long-term storage is also helpful. You should rewind the tapes at an interval of not more than 3 years. This relieves tape pack stresses and provides early warnings for any problems that may have arisen in the last 3 years. Keep it clean. This goes without saying, but dust, smoke, and hair can really mess up a tape. As the tape is being rewound, dust and hair can get sucked into the reel and get squeezed into the film, resulting in quality loss. If you have a cat or a dog, keep them out of the room where you play your tapes, because the electrostatic fields that are created by VCRs and CRT TVs are like dust magnets. In any case, you should clean out your VCR heads using a cleaning tape at least every few years, if not more. And most importantly, play it cool. Temperature and humidity play a massive role in tape longevity. A lot of people think they know, but it is actually crazy how much of a factor this is. A tape stored at 80% humidity and 80 degrees Fahrenheit has an expected lifespan of 3 years. Inversely, a tape stored below 60% humidity and 50 degrees Fahrenheit could last upwards of 70. There are a ton of different ways a tape can fail, but every one of them is accelerated by high heat and high humidity. Buy an air conditioner with an automatic temperature control, and you should be good. There's a lot of other stuff, but those are the four main ones. In my research and experience, weak magnetic fields don't have much, if any, effect on a tape, so if you have some small bookshelf speakers mixed in, you should be fine so long as you follow the other guidelines. I'll link the PDF in the comments, which includes all of the specific numbers for anybody interested. Lastly, digitization. No storage media is truly archival. Let me explain. Everything from tapes to DVDs and hard drives have lifespans. Under the best circumstances, some of these tapes have, at most, 20 years of life left, and some of these tapes were never re-released in digital formats. So at some point, the tape you have on your shelf might be the only one left in the world. As such, I encourage anyone with the time and resources to take up the mantle of media preservation and casually start archiving their collection. The process of preserving this art is an art unto itself, and there's 100 ways to skin a cat. But I'll briefly explain my equipment methodology for archiving. My thought process for archiving and digitization is this. Like, I take the storage side of things very seriously because there is really only one proper way of storing these tapes. And that's mathematical, that's scientific. As far as the digitization side of things goes, Bob's your uncle. And there will inevitably be people who gatekeep this side of any community by saying if you're not using exactly these pieces of equipment or these programs, and if you're not following this exact process, you're doing it wrong and you shouldn't be doing it. And that is in my mind absolutely wrong, because archiving is just one of those things where the more, the better. Whatever you got, whatever you can make, you should be able to do it. And if somebody doesn't like it, then they can go find another rip. Like, they don't have to watch yours. At the end of the day, there's been a few things that I've found over the last 5 years of trying this out that might be helpful for you. And I'll just show you some of those pieces of equipment right now. So there are many different ways that you can go about capturing analog video signals and encoding them. I will go over a few of them, and by no means are these the right methods or the wrong methods. They are just that. Methods of getting this video onto a computer with a reasonable amount of quality. The first method for capturing these, which is certainly the lowest barrier of entry, would be something like this Roxio Video Capture USB. It's a composite to a USB 2. It boots into a program, and you use that program to record the video feed. These are the only capture method that I would not recommend. Okay, I would not recommend these. I've owned about 4 of these, and they last about 3 months, and they shit out. The quality isn't like anything to write home about, but it's certainly usable. I used to use these for my Twitch streams, and they were good enough. They got the job done. The next options are going to be ones that I actually recommend and that work fairly well. The next up would be the composite or S-video to HDMI converters. Now, there are tons of these that you can buy on Amazon or eBay. The basic idea is that you plug your VCR through the composite or the S-video input. S-video is better in this case if you have a VCR that supports it, and that'll pump it out to an HDMI signal. Now, you can do a lot with this HDMI signal. You can also use this to plug your VCR into newer smart TVs that lack coaxial or composite connections. But you can also feed it to a video game capture device or a capture card, like an Elgato, or in my case, I have an EVGA XR1 capture card. And then that just goes into OBS, and you can record it just the same way you would a web camera. Essentially, the one downside to this is that it is upscaling your footage to 720 or 1080p, depending on the settings that you use, so you don't get the base resolution and aspect ratio. If you want to have a 4x3 aspect ratio after you're done recording on this, you have to then take it into another program and crop in on it. So it's acceptable, I suppose, but not ideal. The next solution is one that I would recommend, and honestly, I think gives you the best bang for the buck, I suppose. It would be an AverMedia PCI direct capture card for your computer. So this works on Windows, up to Windows 10, although future compatibility with 11 isn't guaranteed. But at least for now, this is one of the few solutions that allows you to plug your VCR or your video game console, even PlayStation 2s and PlayStation 1s, directly into your computer. There is very little loss that's incurred by these devices. Even with the HDMI upscaler, you have a lot of moving parts and pieces and cable that are all kind of running around, and you can get some added dB loss inside of the video feed just from it having to be converted through all of those steps. This is just a one and done. It's very simple. These are only like $100, honestly, it's been working great for some of the stuff that I've been doing. If you're looking at the more professional side of things, you can always go with SCART cards. Like SCART capture cards also support things like denoising, and they're very modular, and you can kind of make your own capture method with them. So it's very do-it-yourself, and the pre-built ones are fairly expensive. But if you're really looking to get into digitization and really want the most out of it, just look up SCART capture devices and kind of start going through the guides on there. A lot of people from the retro gaming community tend to err more towards those, but a lot of them seem to support DVI outputs or inputs, so you need to find specific converters to do that sort of work as well. There's a fair bit more to that discussion, but that could be a whole video unto itself. In the meantime, if you get one of these and you got a decent VCR, you should be pretty much good to go. after you get this, after you find your preferred capture method, then there is the issue of storage. The most important thing to keep in mind is that flash memory, like solid-state hard drives and USB sticks, are non-archival. That means that if they are ever to shit out, there is nothing that anybody can do to get that information off of them. They are not to be trusted, and they could shit out at any time for any reason. Generally speaking, they're guaranteed for a certain number of hours or years, but that's only important for warranty information. There isn't anything that the company can do when you lose all of your data on it. So I would advise against storing anything on flash memory. At this point, there are only two safe bets: redundant array storage using traditional hard disks, or cold storage on something like Blu-ray discs. Blu-ray discs have a similar issue of degradation, but they last for much longer. Some people put the lifespan of Blu-ray discs up to 150 years, and so long as you're not bumping them around and you're storing them properly, they're pretty much guaranteed to go with very little bit loss over very long periods of time. You do lose out on the convenience of being able to easily access a large amount of files, however. In my case, I just run a DAS with 32 terabytes of storage, and I have it hooked up on a RAID 5. That means that I have one disk of parity, so if any one of these hard drives ends up shitting out, I just replace it with a new drive, and the other disks can backfill the information onto the new drive to restore all of the data that's there, and I move on with my life. This is about $1,000, so not for everybody, certainly. You can just get away with having your data spread out among a bunch of smaller hard drives at the end of the day. Not ideal, but if one of those drives shits out, at least you're not losing your data or a considerable portion of it, depending on how you have the files copied or duplicated. So yeah, that's, without rambling too much, that's pretty much the quick and dirty of it. I had a couple more things that I wanted to go into, but it's all kind of redundant. The stuff that I covered should give you a good base, and I'll link some additional reading down below if you're interested. Apart from that, I recently came across like 6 terabytes of AMVs from the early 2000s, so I guess I'll just leave us off on one of those. And until next time, keep fighting the good fight, and this was The Smuggler, signing off.